Smoking is injurious to health. It causes cancer.
ধূমপান স্বাস্থ্য পক্ষে ক্ষতিকারক। এহা দ্বারা ক্যান্সার হুয়ে।
Permitted to return to my vertical. That is the relationship between the images in dream, in montage, and in poetry is they are related because they are held together by either an emotion or a meaning that they have in common, rather than by the logic of action. In other words, it isn't that one action leads to another action, and this is what I would call a horizontal development, but they are gathered up, brought to a center, and gathered up and collected by the fact that they all refer to a common emotion, although the incidents themselves may be quite disparate. Whereas in what I called a horizontal development, the logic is a logic of actions. In a vertical development, it is a logic of a central emotion or idea which attracts to itself even disparate images which contain that central core which they have in common. This to me is the structure of poetry. So that, for example, you could have a dramatic development in the sense of a horizontal development for a while, as I said in Shakespeare. And let us take the monologues, where in a poetic or a vertical structure, he brings together all various images that relate to the feeling, let us say, of indecision. Now, what I mean there by it being essentially a horizontal development is that it would have sufficed for Hamlet to say, I can't make up my mind, and that's all, and that would not have affected the drama of the play, do you see? The poetic monologue there is, as it were, outside it, or built upon it as a pyramid at that point, as a means of intensifying or illuminating that moment in the horizontal development. And the montage, and that is why film, I believe, lends itself particularly to the poetic statement, because it is essentially a montage, and therefore seems by its very nature to be a poetic medium.
What am I journeying into through listening to Maya Deren and then seeing Maya Mirko? Other than the word Maya, nothing apparently holds them together, I suppose. Nirad Mahapatra did not fit into the discourse of horizontal development of actions with those vertical moments in the narrative. The emotion of quietude, Shantiras, either blended them or pushed beyond in his Maya.
Ah. ओम सवे कुले हरे ओम भूर्भुवः
कौन बोलो आउ दी कप चा आसु
चा ना हो किछ म सकल दिस रही सलानी बाजार गले खाइबो
ओडिया युवकंक कृतित्व ओडिया युवकंक विदेश यात्रा से प्रथम ओडिया शिट मैन ए ओडिया खबर का जडा काई किनु छ
ओहो तू आइस पहिले कोन सिंधु बाहरी मन
कोन प्रथम ओडिया
ना माने से राज्यपाल पुरस्कार प्राप्त प्रधान शिक्षक श्रीयुक्त राजकिशोर चौधरी पुत्र
एवं विशिष्ट स्वाधीनता संग्रामी जमीदार श्री बैरीगंजन चौधरी नाती
आ सर्वश्रेष्ठ रे तांगा सान भाई श्रीयुक्त बुलू चौधरी एथरे परीक्षा दैछन
सकल सकल गोडे बालुनी
ओडिया युवक विदेश यात्रा बजार जीव पर ड्रेस असल हो
भाजा खाया कि दि बुले तुम सेकंड क्लास है
कते परसेंट अच्छे
51% के पिंटू की
बुलु सामना को
I wanted to keep them at a distance. This is the reason why a lot of people talked about why my America didn't have a close-up. So I never go too close. I always play it subdued. And I always want the audience to participate in it. I mean, one of the ways in which you can ask the audience to come closer is by keeping him at a distance. So he feels that, you know, there is something that he's trying to say, but he's not taking me too close. So he makes an effort. To go closer. And I think this spiritual space is created by what in the Ras theory we have Santras. You know, Santras is something which was not there with Bharat Muni. It was done later on, aided by Abhinav Gupta. And he says that when a film or any work ends with a note of tranquility, you know, where people are made to think. You see, because Santras is something, if it agitates your mind or it, for example, in the Western theory, you know, you have the cathartic effect. So catharsis is something that happens to you, but by the time you walk out of the theater, the catharsis is done and you have already forgotten all about it. But only when you have Santras, then it lingers in your mind.
At that time, when you made Mayamruga, theatres yes. were very yes. active and
yes.
alive.
Yes.
But your take
yes.
in cinema
yes.
was in direct conflict with mm-hmm. this collective entertainment space of theaters. Yes.
But that is true of all these regional cinemas. Actually, if you look at it, even in the heydays when the so-called new Indian New Wave was ruling the art cinema block. Even then, you always had 99% films anywhere in any country, I suppose, is mainstream cinema. It's only a parallel stream, which is a very thin stream, which runs side by side with it. And of course, it has completely dried up in case of India after the 90s. But even in the 80s, My Amerigo, for example, when it was released only for one show, all over Odisha. They refused to release it on a regular basis, saying this film will not get audience in the second show, which means 9 to 12 at night. They said this is not the kind of film which will run, so the best thing to run it is only in the matinee shows or in the morning shows. So that is how the whole, the entire the region, all over Odisha, wherever it was released, it was never released on a regular basis. So that has been a problem with the different, with the other kind of cinema, with the filmmakers who make films, of a different kind. So that's true of all. I don't know if in Bengal and Kerala and Karnataka partly, the story is slightly different. But in Odisha, it has always been like this.
Yeah, so now, when I asked this question, when did you go to a cinema hall to see a film last?
Yes.
Most of those people who answered me, actors, filmmakers, they have gone to a theater like Life of Pi or Spider-Man, where it's spectacular.
Yes.
So the drawing factor to a cinema hall is somewhere connected with the spectacular nature of cinema.
Well, for me, it doesn't work like that. Actually, I would see anything which is which I consider to be a very important film. For example, I went to see Lagan. I went to see Barfi. Not because it is spectacular, but because, there were reviews which said, it's very different from the general run-of-the-mill kind of cinema. And, there's something which is of interest. So I just go to see a film when it becomes a big blockbuster. Like Dabang. Or it's a film which is talked about because it's different from the run-of-the-mill. So there are two kinds of films in which I am interested in seeing. I went to see Dabang to see what really clicks with the audience.
That's Salman Khan film.
Salman Khan film. And I went to see Barfi and Lagan to see how, within the framework of a commercial film, what are the difference that the storytelling method makes, or the kind of style that a filmmaker has. That is my interest in, because also I teach, students are more interested in talking about a film which they have seen recently, and something which interests them. So that is also part of the reason why I see some of these films, Barfi, Dabang, even I like Kahani very much, because that is one Indian film that I saw where there are no diversions. It doesn't break into a song, or it doesn't go. It keeps to its own line, and it maintains that storytelling right through the film. There's hardly anything which you can call a kind of a distraction, which normally is there in most of the other Indian films. And it's a true genre film, because it talks about suspense, and suspense is all that it does. It's all the time trying to unravel the story. It's trying to give you the kind of clues to what is happening, and so that is the kind of cinema that I would like to see. And it was a commercially successful film.
So, forgive me if I am offending you. So, if this Nirad Patra, the viewer, who is in search of finding out that what is that narrative which works.
Yes.
And also, so there is a curiosity new.
Yes.
The compulsion is maybe as a teacher,
yes,
but there is a curiosity
yes,
to know.
Sure.
So this Nirad Mahapatra, the viewer would not have gone and seen Maya Mriga in the theatre. This Nirad Mahapatra.
No, he would have, because when I made this film, I saw a number of people I shouldn't be saying this, but even after how many years, more than 25 years after I made this film, even today I meet people, and when they come to know that I had made that film, they still remember it. I think that film was seen partly because of the All India publicity, of course. I mean, because a lot of reviews came out in the national papers and all that, everybody was giving rave reviews. So that was one point for, you know, one thing for which people went and saw it. But people who saw it, they liked it so much that, the word spread that it's a film which people should see. I mean, so we had the middle class intelligentsia going and seeing it. If I was not even a filmmaker, somebody had made a film of that kind, I would have gone and seen it. Even today, I go to see films that Sushant makes or Manmohan makes, or Manmohan's films are not really seen in the theaters regularly. But so I would be interested in seeing somebody's work which is a breakaway from the ordinary routine kind of films. That even today I will do.
So the viewer in you, yes, is not a parallel cinema viewer. He is a viewer who is open to cinema.
Yes, I do consider that one must have an open mind, and I still think that people, if they are given a choice and they are exposed to better cinema, they would still like good cinema. I mean, not that they would give up seeing the mainstream cinema, but at least given a choice, I mean, if they had an avenue where they could see the other kind of cinema, they would certainly visit it once in a while.
So now, in this context of metro-centric multiplex theatres...
There are very few artists who could signal you to provoke them. Nirad Mahapatra kept that signal on always.
A long time ago, I had stood by the shore, hesitant but expectant, and waited for the sea to bring the drowning waves to soothe the parching ache. I stood by the shore and waited, full of youthful expectations, eager dread and apprehensions. But all too soon one day, I stood by the shore, feeling used, wasted, and rejected. As I realized, the waves had come and gone their way without even touching me. Only my slowly drying body telling me the waves had come and gone their way. Today, I stand by the shore and wait, foolishly confident that the waves will come once more and truly touch my shore. Until then, I keep vigil by the shore, waiting for the willful waves to come and touch me.
Making a film of my kind, you see, you should always think of the budget. You see, this is the reason why, unlike Fellini, who can go really widescreen and big budget and that kind of canvas. You see, I mean, none of the Indian filmmakers can think of it, because considering the kind of audience he has in mind, considering the kind of potential that the film is going to draw. In terms of audience, he cannot think of making anything in regional films, I can say that beyond a crore and crore and a half. In India, Odisha, of course, I mean, one cannot think of today, you can't make a film for 5 lakhs, which I did in 1984, with 16mm blow up and all that. It's another story that the negative got spoiled and all that, just because, the technology actually is not up to date. And. There's a lot of mishandling in the laboratories and all that. But that apart, budget has become a constraint for all of us. I mean, we never think big in that sense. You see, I mean, we always think of minimum characters, minimum location, minimum of crew, so that we can sort of cut it down to a size where it will be, if it works with the audience, then it should be manageable. And the money should be coming back, if not the entire money, a large part of it should be coming back to you. So you consider that there is a minor audience which is likely to come to the audience, to the theater, to see your film. So you plan your film accordingly. With the change in technology, I think it also helps the new filmmakers, because digital technology is something where he would not have the constraint of ratio. For example, you in 35, you can't shoot at 1:10 ratio if you are a filmmaker of making a different kind of cinema. Today, you can do that because you are shooting with a digital camera. And the digital technology has completely wiped out the film technology in a way in the post-shooting stage. I mean, all the editing, everything, it has become so easy to handle it. You don't have to make too many rush prints, work print, all that. That is one. Secondly, this multiplex also helps the good filmmakers in a way, because good filmmakers make films with a small audience in mind. You see, and it is in the multiplexes that you have 400 seaters. In the thousand, like for example, if Mayamiruga had been made at a time when multiplexes existed, probably a multiplex owner would have agreed to release my film on a regular basis, because he knows maybe 400, if not 400, for the night show also maybe 200 people will come. But for a theater which has 1,000 capacity, he would think if 200 comes, this fellow is not going to recover even the rental of the theater. So how is he going to run this film? He will be running it at a loss. So that is why he will tell you that if I release it only in one show, then there will be more audience in it. So that is how I think technology in a way has helped us, the other kind of cinema, to be possible, to be feasible. So that is my take. I mean, multiplexes.
But you are not visible today as a filmmaker, yes. Even when the technology has liberated you. And after Mayamruga,
yes,
it is unthinkable, especially when...
You know, looking at the market around you, looking at the kind of films being made, the kind of taste people have developed, the kind of audience profile that you have today. For example, in 1984, when I made the film, I have seen a number of families coming with the entire, with children. So that kind of audience has simply vanished. That has disappeared. What has taken place, the change that has taken place over the years is, today you have people who come to the audience. If you take the audience profile, you will find 90% of the audience is composed of people aged between 20 to 30. None of the senior citizens, none of the middle-aged people, they come to see a film in a theater, because it is the middle-class intelligentsia which realizes that it's not up to their taste. You see, and they would always think twice before taking the family to the theater, because they think there may be a scene somewhere which will make them uncomfortable. You see, I mean, this is what I'm saying, that the audience profile has changed. The market, now it is totally market-driven. In 1984, you still had a minor audience existing in Odisha which wanted to see something different. Today, people have really given up hope. You see, they think every theater, every film that is being released is something which will definitely have a scene somewhere, you know. There are very few exceptions to that rule, like films like, as I said, Kahani, Barfi. You see, I mean, they don't have anything which would offend the family sentiment. But by and large, if you look at it, the general trend is that there has to be a dance sequence where there are those half nudes, dancing in the background and all that. That kind of stuff is something that any family man would somehow, be very, he would be reluctant to take his entire family and see it with them. So that is the difference that it has made. And I could make a film in 5 lakhs, which was recoverable. Today, you cannot make a film with less than 30 lakhs, which is not recoverable, so far as the minor audience is concerned, particularly in Odisha, I'm saying. It may be true of Bengal, Karnataka, Kerala, where the minority audience also is a fairly large audience, you see, which can sustain that kind of work. Here, it's very difficult to do that. So that's my only problem.
So where do you express yourself? You are expressing these things through your classes or your writing?
I think, yes. I think because I was fortunate in a way, because I began my career as a teacher. After passing out from 72 to 74, I was teaching at the Film Institute. And I always proudly tell people that that is the time when Film Institute produced the best of directors. It produced Ketan Mehta, Girish Kasarwali, Saeed Mirza, and all of them were my students in a way. Because I was teaching direction and I was teaching film theory and history, study of films, direct analysis of directors and all that. So that is the time when, that is how I began my career. I didn't start as a filmmaker, because I came back to Odisha, stayed here for a year. I didn't quite see much scope for any work, not even documentaries. So in 72, I got a call from them saying that, can you come and teach? So that is how it all happened. So for the first 2 years of my career, I was a teacher. And then I came here, started a film society and edited magazines. So I keep on writing also. Today, these days, I don't write much. But that is how I channelize my creative energy, I think, by teaching, by talking to young students. And I get great pleasure out of that. So that's how it has been happening.
What was the most fertile, fruitful, creative period of Oriya cinema?
I would say 60s. I do consider that Mrinal Babu's Matrimony Sir gave Oriya cinema a facelift. It's a milestone in Oriya cinema. Although I have seen parts of the Malajana and all that, Matrimony Sir was not really liked in Odisha for a very different reason. Because Mrinal Babu, I would say that Matrimony Sir was his first political film, in the sense, if you see the film vis-a-vis the novel, where the entire sympathy of the writer was with the older brother, because the writer is trying to to catch hold of the sentiments of the tradition of the feudal system of the older brother being the eldest in the family gets the maximum property and he has a say in everything, and the younger brother. So he just turned it around. You know, he said the younger brother also has a right. He has a right to his life. He has a right to what he wants to do. If he wants to go to Calcutta and be a industrial labor, I mean, that he should be free to do it, and he should have a right. So that is why in Odisha people didn't like it, because he made a deviation from the original novel. But if you look at it as a cinematic work, I think that is one of the very brilliant works that he has done. I would still consider Matrimony Sir to be Mrinal Babu's one of his best, finest films.
But the writer,
yes,
I was told, said that he had a Gandhian concept towards the end of the film.
That's right.
But
that's right.
Mrinal Babu made it.
Gave it a Marxist. Yes, that is precisely what I'm saying. That it's a political film because he had turned it around. Instead of Gandhian philosophy, he introduced the philosophy of a kind of a it was more political in the sense that he had all his sympathies with the younger brother, whereas in the novel itself, you know, the younger brother is sort of run down because he is being selfish, he is defying his elder brother and all that. So the entire complexion of the story changed, you see, and that is precisely why that film was not very much talked about. It was not seen by a large audience. And it was, in a way, you know, a total failure in so far as commercial aspect of it is concerned. But as a cinematic work, I think it's a very good work.
Hey. आज भारी खुशी है
कौन है देखी देखी काम कला मन तो कोठ रख तो था था दरकार नहीं तोरा काम करिया जा
मन तो जाई कुआड़े तेरे उड़ुचे उठी यात्रा देखिबु उठी मेला को जिबु कामरे केमती मन लागिबु तू बस हला बासा हेलु सब दिन कोन सेई चगला ढंग रखितबु ए संसार को हमें आसीचे काम करिया निकम है बसिले पाप बुझिलु भगवान सेतिर असंतुष्ट
He has got a different climax,
yes.
Short later.
Yes, yes. But that is because, you know, the producer was not happy and he wanted, this is what has been happening all in the entire history of cinema. I mean, if you look at that German film, The Last Laugh or something, that film, when it was released in Hollywood, they said, no, you can't end it like this. He must come back, he must get a lottery ticket, he must become very rich and come back to the same hotel and, you see, I mean, and that bit was added at the end. So this is precisely what the producer thought, you know, he said this film is not running because he has made a deviation, so all that I do is, you know, the younger brother will run after the elder brother and he will get him back to the home, which wasn't the case originally. You see, I mean, this is what happens for commercial considerations. People do make changes in the end so that it becomes a more, satisfying end for the audience. So that is what he hadn't done it. It was added later on, yes.
But it doesn't generally happen because literature is not born by the market compulsions.
Yes.
But the compulsions of a person to express something.
That is true.
Now, yes. The kind of cinema which you are identified with also are, to me, as a viewer, somewhat closer to this spiritual space of art.
Yes.
But cinema is a very physical medium.
Yes.
You have to have a good shot, as you yourself say, a spatio-temporal medium.
Yes.
Now, so you need a space. Need to create.
Yes.
You need to create a body to attain maybe a spiritual level.
Yes.
So, how spiritual or physical is cinema to Nirad Mahapatra?
Cinema is very physical, but how I tried and in my own way to do it in my mirga is that because it is too physical, because it has a tendency to sweep the audience from its feet, and that is normally what people do. I wanted to keep them at a distance. This is the reason why a lot of people talked about why my mirga didn't have a closure. So I never go too close. I always play it subdued, and I always want the audience to participate in it. I mean, one of the ways in which you can ask the audience to come closer is by keeping him at a distance. So he feels that there is something that he's trying to say, but he's not taking me too close. So he makes an effort to go closer, and I think this spiritual space is created by what in the Ras theory we have Santras. Santras is something which was not there with Bharat Muni. It was done later on, aided by Abhinav Gupta. He says that when a film or any work ends with a note of tranquility, where people are made to think. You see, because Santras is something, if it agitates your mind or it... For example, in the Western theory, you have the cathartic effect. So catharsis is something that happens to you, but by the time you walk out of the theater, the catharsis is done and you have already forgotten all about it. But only when you have santras, then it lingers in your mind. And that is what, to my mind, that is the kind of height that cinema can achieve. Beyond that, because I will tell you, I saw a film when I was a student at the Film Institute. We went to see Visconti's adaptation of The Outsider by Camus. If one has read the novel, one knows at the end, the way he describes the sky, the stars, and the kind of spiritual space that he creates in literature, he simply could not do it. Visconti's film falls so flat because anybody who has read the novel knows that the ending of the film does not create the same kind of emotion, because literature is abstract. Literature is something that you imagine things within yourself. It is the word which creates the image. Here, the image is so concrete that it's so very difficult to go beyond the image. You have to reach a point in the film where you go beyond that. And how do you do it? You have to do it with images only. But you have to create a mood of tranquility, a mood where the audience goes into that kind of a, space. And that is what also was my effort, because I have always said that Wuzu is one filmmaker I greatly admire, and Wuzu does it, he is a transcendentalist. That is the kind of experience that he creates towards the end of his films, many of his films, like whether it's Tokyo Story, whether it's Autumn Afternoon. So these are the films which I not only admire, and I try to, to sort of learn something from him and put it in the Indian mold. So that was about how I feel. Cinema is a very, very strong, it has a very strong physiological impact on you. You see, that is why audiences are mostly, dragged by their nose, by a filmmaker. He can do it. It's so easy to do it in that medium. And that is what I was trying to guard against, actually.
I have two more questions.
Yes.
What is your first memory of going to a cinema hall?
Oh, I was so small. I remember I had gone to see a film when I was hardly in class 3 or 4. My exam was over, so I went and saw a film, but you see, this connecting link that when you have developed that kind of a memory, you know, you connect images and you connect the events and the cause and effect and all that. That probably, I didn't quite enjoy the film because probably, you know, I hadn't grown up enough to make sense of the story. You know, it's emotional impact and all that. I saw it shot by shot. So that is what I remember, you see, because when I tried to analyze it later on, I said, why did it happen? Because then I realized that probably, you know, my mind was not mature enough to be able to connect images and create sense out of that. And that is what happened. So that is my earliest encounter with cinema in a film. I went to see Bhai Bhai or something. I remember it's a very old film. Maybe when I was hardly 5 years, 5-6 years. But literacy has spread, cinema literacy has spread like anything. Because of television, today, even a boy of 5, if you leave him in a theater, he would make sense of it. But I couldn't, because in my days, my books never had a photograph, my books never had an illustration. It was all, alphabets that were printed in a book. Today, you have so much of visual material around that children who grow up with the television, you see, right when they're, you know, from the childhood, from when they're babies, and the video and the iPad and the computer and everything, that makes them so very, you know, their memory of images and memories of visuals is so strong that they can always connect up things and make sense of it, which I couldn't. I couldn't when I was young.
If I offend you with my last question,
no,
forgive me.
Not at all. I'm not offended by anybody.
Even Lord Raith, you know, yes. He says, there are some people whom we should offend always. So, I can afford to offend if I ask, sure. Because, you know, you have that sense of security mm-hmm. within you as a person who mm-hmm. expressed, mm-hmm. did it? Walked away and not trying to do anything, you are contented with your life.
Yes.
So there is an Oriya expression I heard.
Yes, yes.
Nirad Mahapatra is a Kadali Gacho.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Kadali Gacho, you know, it blooms and then
it
does not.
And it gives one fruit and then it disappears. It's better to give one fruit than give fruits which are not at all useful to people. You know, there are film. I can say that there are filmmakers who keep on making films, but even after making a dozen films, say a dozen film, if every film is zero into 12 is zero. So I believe that you know, if I have something very important to say, well, I wouldn't give an excuse, but I should have made more films. But the problem is that initially, I think this story is not known to many that. NFDC, I had a great fight with NFDC for several reasons. Because they had completely messed up with the Miami River print in Cannes, where they were supposed to get me a French subtitle print. They had sent it to some place, and it didn't arrive till the last minute. Nobody in NFDC knew what was happening. And at the last minute, when they made an inquiry through the embassy, they found out that well, the subtitle work has not even begun. You know, it hadn't even started. I was so furious, and the jury had to see it because it was the first film of the filmmaker for whatever they call it, Pamidior and all that. And the jury felt very unhappy because, you know, there was a running commentary in French translation. And it was an English subtitle print. So that is what made our relationship very sore. And I had fights with NFDC, and that distracted me. Then they wanted to punish me by asking me to pay back the money and all that. So all that is history, so I don't have to say that. But for 3 years, I was doing only documentary films. And by the time I realized that, well, I have paid the loan back and all that, and I should start a film. But I was deep into documentary filmmaking and making films for All India agencies, and that got me distracted for several years. And when I actually wanted to make one, then I saw that the things have changed around me. The market force was something which hadn't existed when I made it in 1984. So late 90s, when I wanted to make a film, the script I had, the locations I had, they had all sort of disappeared. The steam engine had disappeared, the mango groves had disappeared, and urbanization was moving very fast in Odisha. And so all that happened, and so I thought, the best way to do is to be happy with whatever you have and make documentaries, make films, short films whenever it is possible, and then go into teaching or writing and all that kind of stuff. So that is what has happened. Mm.
So the tranquility which you are talking about, is it happening in you as an artist by detaching yourself from the market?
No, I mean, I think, one thing is art, one thing is cinema, the other thing is life. In life, if you feel contented with whatever you have and whatever way means you have of expression or expressing your ideas, whether through writing or through, talking to the students or whatever, it channelizes itself. I mean, I think, in that sense, I'm not truly a professional filmmaker, because if you realize, I made a film 12 years after passing out from the institute. 71 I passed out. I made a film in 1983, completed it. 84 was the year when it was released, actually. I mean, the censor date and all that. But I waited for 12 years for my chance. And it so happened that OFDC was giving loans to people through NFDC to make films of their own choice. So that choice is no more there. NFDC, I would also blame, in a way, the government policies. NFDC is in a moribund state. Think of the Film Institute, the entire place is, it has diluted it, its courses, and it's not the same place where I was there. And you look at the market, there is, all subsidies have been withdrawn from all over the place. There are very few states which are giving subsidies. So in a way, if you do not encourage filmmakers who want to do something different, it becomes very difficult to stand on your own. Filmmakers who have got international connections, who have got their own marketing strategies, have got their own networks, are successful. There are very few people today who are making individual efforts to be able to get their money back, to make this kind of cinema, the kind of cinema that I would like to make, and somehow still exist in the market. They depend mostly on outside market. They don't depend on Indian cinema market. So that's, and I'm bad at PR. I'm bad at networking. I don't do that. I never done it. So I don't have an agent to sell my product. So that is my my problem. So I'm unfit probably for the for the age in which I'm living.
Fly away into the wind, gentle soul, and become the breath of the universe. Fly away to the heavens, brave soul, and be a star among the stars to light the path of timid wayfarers. Fly away to the skies, loving soul, and be the rain and return in showers to soothe her burning soul, so that when the wind blows, I'll hear your whispers. When the star shines, I'll find my way. And when I feel the rain, I'll know that you touch the earth in me once again.